I want to just to remind you that we do have some learning objectives, which I believe you'll see from the outline of my talk. I've tried to follow pretty directly. So just a little bit about myself. Why did UMC ask me to speak on vaccine pharmacovigilance? You might be able to hear from my accent. I come from the United States, where I trained as a physician in both internal medicine and infectious diseases. And I had the fortune, I guess you could say, to meet a European. So I moved to Sweden now almost 8 years ago. And I was lucky enough to get a job at the Swedish Drug Regulatory Agency, the Swedish Medical Products Agency. That was a bit of an interesting opportunity that I had because I had never worked in drug regulation. I had never worked in the drug industry before. I was simply a clinical infectious diseases doctor. So I came to work there and I worked in the pharmacovigilance department. So it was a completely new introduction to pharmacovigilance. And I had the opportunity to be involved in the initial evaluation of the applications for the approvals of the pneumococcal vaccines, Prevnar and Synflorix. And I very much liked that work. And then here in Sweden, here in Europe, and particularly in Sweden, we had an incident with the vaccine for the pandemic influenza, H1N1 influenza. We used a particular vaccine here by the name of Pandemrix. And maybe you have heard the story, but we had an enormous number of children, both in Sweden and Finland primarily, who were subsequently diagnosed with narcolepsy. And this event, I would say, changed my life. It became something that I felt very passionate about. I became very interested in vaccine safety and the evolving science of vaccine safety. So I came to here to UMC about a year and a half ago, and I've been working with vaccines in that role since that time, and trying to develop more of a vaccine program here at UMC. It had been a little dormant for a little while. So that's the little introduction about me, and I'll get started. So again, the outline of my talk, I hope, follows the objectives that we set out for you before. I'm going to give a short introduction. I'm going to talk about the special considerations we have for vaccine pharmacovigilance. I mean, why do we have a separate session on vaccines? A little bit of vaccine basics. Maybe you will have heard a lot of this, but it's always good to review. In fact, it was very good for me to review. I always learn a little something new. And then, actually, one of the big parts of the talk that I feel like is the most important is how do vaccines cause adverse events? And then we're going to talk more the nuts and bolts of how we do vaccine pharmacovigilance. And this is where I anticipate we'll generate a lot of discussion, and I hope that we do. And then a little bit about vaccine signal follow-up. That's not really the work that I'm involved in. It's more in signal detection and not how we follow up maybe with investigative things, but I want to touch on some of the options that there are. And then in the last hour, after the fika, after the coffee break, I have an example of a signal that I worked on since I've been here. And since we haven't really had the signal detection lectures, they'll come next week, I thought we could really do this together rather than as a separate workshop. So this was very interactive, and I'll have a lot of questions for you. So, introduction. I have only one slide for this section, but vaccine pharmacovigilance has been a special priority of the WHO, and they have developed a global blueprint on how to increase the vaccine safety efforts throughout the world. And in this blueprint, they've had a number of tasks for which they've gone and collaborated with the SIOMS group, where it's a group that brings together people from regulatory industry as well as public health to come up with guidelines and to harmonize the work, shall we say. And one of the things that they've done is they've made a SIOMS guide in which they define and they talk about the application of terms for vaccine pharmacovigilance. So that's where I like to take the definition of what this is. So vaccine pharmacovigilance is defined as the science and activities related to the detection, assessment, understanding, prevention, and communication of adverse events following immunization. So I'm sure most of you have seen it, but you're going to see that shortened AEFIs a lot throughout this presentation, but also of other vaccine or immunization-related issues. So on to special considerations for vaccine pharmacovigilance. And again, kind of the subtitle for this is, why are we having 3 extra hours on this? The other question that a lot of people ask, are vaccines the same as drugs? Do we treat them the same? A very controversial topic, potentially. But we do know that vaccines, I have a certain respect for vaccines in knowing that, you know, this is a medical intervention that we give to healthy persons, primarily infants and children. And we give it for diseases that we actually don't know that the patient would actually ever be exposed to or become sick from. We give them to very large proportions of the population. And in certain circumstances, vaccines are mandated so that people don't have a personal choice. They're often administered concomitantly. So from the very beginning, we're making it a little more difficult for ourselves to figure out exactly if a certain vaccine caused an adverse event, because it's not uncommon for children to receive 2 or 3 or even 4 at the same time. As we have progressed, the perception of patients for vaccines, you know, is getting smaller, because we have been so successful in eliminating or decreasing a lot of the diseases that we once had. So for patients, when they look around and see that the incidence of the disease is low, they question why they need the vaccine. I heard you had a talk on biologicals, and that Sten mentioned and asked whether vaccines were similar. And yes, they are. Vaccines are complex biological products that are a complex mixture of microorganisms or parts of the microorganism, adjuvants, preservatives. There's a little antibiotics in there. We'll go into that later. And that each round that a company makes of a vaccine can be different. There can be small variations in these products because they're biological agents. We also know that vaccines are a little different than, you know, what we think of as a pill that sits in the medicine cabinet there. Vaccines require special considerations for storage and handling and transport and administration, particularly the live attenuated vaccines. We'll talk about that. And that, you know, if these aren't done correctly, we can have adverse events that are related to that. We also are having an increasing appreciation that vaccines can cause adverse events, and we don't really understand why. This would be the case of pandemics and narcolepsy. People are still working to figure out what happened there. And I think that's where my real interest in this stems from. Also, the very challenging thing about vaccines, particularly when you talk about a global perspective, is that the benefit-risk profile can be very different and can be very dynamic. The benefit-risk profile for a certain vaccine, say in Denmark, may be very different for a country in Africa or even a country from Southeast Asia. So a global perspective has to be thought of at all times, and that the best decisions may need to be local decisions. And as we all know in this room, communication about issues of vaccine safety can be very challenging. I think I'll let that one stand. The other thing that is a special consideration, which I actually hope that I can learn more from you, is the fact that vaccine safety, the responsibility for vaccine safety, may be different for different countries. My experience has primarily been actually in Europe, although I'm American, I traditionally have had my experience in vaccine pharmacovigilance in the European system, in the EMA. But I know that in a lot of other countries that the national immunization programs have a lot of responsibility. So the WHO has gone out in their blueprint to say that AEFI surveillance must be closely integrated with those programs that administer the vaccines, the national immunization programs. And therefore, the national regulatory or pharmacovigilance centers haven't been so directly involved. But we here at the UMC really do believe that there should be a close collaboration between the immunization program and the pharmacovigilance centers, and that we have to share information. And one of the primary reasons that we believe that is because we believe that some of the signals that are done by the people administering the vaccine, they may be different than the type of safety signals that we may find stepping back in the pharmacovigilance center, looking at a large amount of data from a number of places. And I'll go into that a little bit more. But I would like to know, I'm going to stop here so I can get something from you, I'll be honest. I want to know how many of you are working in centers that are seeing AEFI data on a regular basis? And you work at regulatory agencies, or you I know that you work at...
It's a mix.
So that wasn't too many? I saw some hesitant hands. Okay. So this is also a special consideration slide. This was one that I actually recently added. As you might be able to see, this is a rather recent occurrence. I think that we are also getting ready to enter a very interesting time, a new time. We're breaking new ground, as is exemplified here. This was in April of this year. That the first vaccine against dengue was introduced into the Philippines. And of course, this is a vaccine that has not been used in some of the ICH countries in the United States or in Europe first. I guess Menafrovac would be another example, but we know the Ebola vaccines as well. So traditionally, vaccines have been introduced into lower and middle income countries after years of use in the US and in Europe and in other ICH countries. And so when that happens, they typically have a rather large amount of post-marketing data, both on how effective they are as well as safety. But now we have a growing number of examples where new vaccines are being introduced directly into lower and middle income countries. And therefore, not to be threatening or anything like that, but there's going to be a greater responsibility on the systems in lower and middle income countries to detect these signals, because we know that signals typically arise in the post-marketing period. It'll be talked again about next week, but you know, one of the biggest things about pharmacovigilance is that the clinical trials are limited, and even for vaccines where they tend to be a little larger than other types of drugs, we still know that we really learn about a drug when we finally introduce it into the real world and we give it to a large number of real people, not in the context of a clinical trial. So, back to the outline. So, vaccine basics. So, we know that there are numerous different types of vaccines, which have a variety of different components. They're cocktails in a sense. And oftentimes they have different requirements for storage, they have different routes of administration, and all of these variations can have effects for its safety profile. And so a knowledge of these differences is very important, as different vaccines that are given different ways and have different ingredients can cause different types of adverse events. And I'm going to totally credit this. I have taken the next chunk of this presentation from the Vaccine Safety Basics e-learning course. If you have not seen it before or you didn't know it existed, I have left the website there. And it's really a fantastic overview of the nuts and bolts of this whole area. And there's about five modules, and I believe what I'm giving you now is from module 2, which is just some basic information on vaccines. So we have many different types of vaccines, which we'll go into a little bit here. We have live attenuated vaccines. Examples there are BCG for tuberculosis, oral polio, which has been in the news recently because we have tried to convert over to an inactivated polio on a rather global scale. Measles, rotavirus, and yellow fever. We also have inactivated wholesale vaccines. This is wholesale pertussis, inactivated polio. Subunit vaccines, I've listed some there. Hepatitis B and pneumococcal vaccine probably being the most important there. Toxoid vaccines, including tetanus and diphtheria. And I will go through these in a little bit more detail. So first, starting with the live attenuated vaccines. I guess these are the vaccines I would, in a way, in my language, I would say that I respect them the most. They're the ones that we have to be a little cautious for a number of reasons that I hope to highlight here. So a live attenuated vaccine is essentially a live form of the microorganism, which causes a mild form of disease. That's why we have to be a little bit more careful and be a little bit more watchful. But I must say, I also, as an infectious diseases physician, I respect them also because I believe that this is the best type of immunity that we can get. The best type of immunity a person can get is from actually having the infection. So we're growing more and more to understand that an immune response from a natural infection varies, is more durable, is more extensive than from different parts of the organism. So we get a good payoff with these vaccines, but we have to be careful because there is the rare potential that they can revert to fully pathogenic forms and cause disease, such as with oral polio vaccine. We also know that patients with compromised immune systems may not respond, but they may be more likely to get a form of the disease which can cause harm. Also, when it comes to the preparation and the handling, because these are microorganisms, they're pretty finicky. They have to be grown on a tissue culture, which is subject to contamination. They also have to be stored in a certain way. They have to be kept cold. They might need to be on the cold chain. There is an increased potential for errors that are related to all these steps of manufacturing and keeping it preserved and actually administering it. So they're a bit more difficult, and that can have consequences for the adverse events that you may see from these vaccines. So there are some well-characterized that we know of adverse events that we know with these vaccines that are both common and rare. And I just highlight some of these as they did on the WHO website to just think about. So with BCG, we have disseminated BCG and osteitis. As we mentioned before, we also have paralytic poliomyelitis. For measles vaccine, we have febrile seizures, thrombocytopenic purpura, and anaphylaxis. My own little child, when he got his MMR vaccine, about a week later, he was quite ill for 2 days with a pretty high fever and a rash head to toe. It was very interesting. My two older children, they didn't have this effect at all. They were quite fine, but he managed to get through it, and it was fine. But, you know, he had a mild case of measles. Rotavirus, intussusception, and then yellow fever vaccine, a lot of these vaccine-associated neurotropic and viscerotropic disease. And we'll touch again on this later, but just so. So now on to the second type of vaccines, the inactivated whole cell vaccines. So these are essentially the microorganism, the bug, which has been inactivated, so no longer a live attenuated form, actually killed. The trade-off, this is, tends to be more safe. Patients aren't susceptible to get a mild form of the disease. But the trade-off is that we may not stimulate the same type of immune response. We may not get as extensive or durable, one that lasts as long. So we can see that at times the vaccine is ineffective in patients. We also might see that we have breakthrough disease later on if a person isn't receiving a boosting of this later on in life. So the best examples are really whole cell vaccine and inactivated polio vaccine. And whole cell pertussis vaccine, it's pretty well characterized that we have some neurological adverse events with these drugs, with seizures and hypotonic hyporesponsive episode, where infants can become a bit floppy and can be a little bit unresponsive. But this has been pretty well characterized. They've done longer studies to look at infants who have experienced these episodes, and they don't see any lasting neurological consequences. So you can find a lot of information about that. Moving on to the third type of vaccine, subunit vaccines. So these are vaccines that actually only contain a part of the organism. So we've gone from a live attenuated version to a dead whole one to now just a part. and it's that part of the organism that is thought to stimulate the greatest immune response. That part of the organism can be a protein. It can be a polysaccharide. But they've also developed vaccines now that they can actually take a polysaccharide portion of it and conjugate it onto a protein, because our immune responses from polysaccharides in and of themselves aren't as strong. So we have several versions here. Either it can just be a protein, or it can just be a sugar, or it can be a sugar on a protein. Can say, I guess. So, again, these tend to be safer, so I guess we can say, than, again, these live attenuated forms. But again, the exchange is the immune response of the same quality? And they do say that there's actually no guarantee that an immune response will have memory. So one of the things that you get, as I've mentioned before a couple of times about the immune response from vaccines, as we're learning, actually developing a T cell response or developing a long-term memory response may require a natural infection, and maybe these things that we do in vaccines don't do that. So we have to be very careful, not to say that they're not good vaccines, but we have to be vigilant to decide if we need to adjust our vaccination programs to deal with waning immunity, shall we say. So again, some of these vaccines have pretty well characterized adverse events for which we have information on how often they occur, etc. Hepatitis vaccine can be associated with anaphylaxis. Pertussis vaccine. So we also have a version of an acellular pertussis vaccine. The whole cell we had in the previous example, an acellular version actually tends to have less neurological consequences, less febrile seizures, less hypotonic hyporesponsive episode. However, as we're really learning now in Europe and America, where we've been using acellular pertussis vaccine, we're seeing a lot of pertussis outbreaks in highly vaccinated populations. So this is really thought now to be secondary to the fact that we do not develop the type of immune response that will be long-lasting. So we are in the process, lots of countries are in the process of how do we deal with this now. We've been giving a cellular vaccine now for a generation, and now they're growing up and they're responsible for spreading disease. So a big hot topic at the moment now about acellular pertussis vaccines In fact, I've even seen recently on Medscape a call to go back to wholesale vaccines. So other some other examples, Haemophilus doesn't really have any, and the pneumococcal vaccines either. And the conjugated meningococcal vaccines, fever, urticaria, and bronchospasm, I saw was really the only thing. I should say, in these examples of the subunit vaccines, in general, these really have very few safety concerns. When you look back at vaccines that have been introduced into more recent years, HPV, pneumococcal disease, and some of these other ones, hepatitis B, the pneumococcal vaccines, I think, are an incredible success story because they really they really don't have any serious important safety concerns other than the mild local reaction. So I think that they are really an interesting success story. So, and like I said, I'm a little biased. As I mentioned at the beginning, I worked on the initial applications for Prevnar 13 and Synflorix, but they are new, and we need to see on down the line, will we need to boost later? Will the immunity that we have be durable? And so it'll be an interesting story to see. I'm beginning to see a lot of data now on what's happened to pneumococcal rates, at least in the Scandinavian countries. I was recently at a meeting, so it's very interesting. The final group is the toxoid vaccine. So we can develop some vaccines to be toxoid vaccines because the way the pathogenesis of the infection is that the microorganism releases a toxin, which is what causes the damage. So they have developed vaccines that are a non-pathogenic version of the toxin. They make a toxoid so that it's harmless. However, lots of these vaccines, as well as some of the other some examples from the subunit vaccines, when you're taking only a part of the organism or it's just its toxin, sometimes the immune response that you stimulate, it may not be quite strong enough. It's not the same as getting the natural infection. So these tend to use adjuvants in those situations. And with adjuvants, we add another complexity regarding safety. We'll go through that in a minute. But tetanus toxoid and diphtheria toxoid are the good examples here. And it's really with only tetanus toxoid and brachial neuritis, I guess, is the one that I tend to think of. But again, rare, but pretty well characterized. And you can find a lot of information on how commonly that occurs. So we've talked about the different types of vaccines. And now we need to talk about, and I tried to highlight there's different safety issues. Now we need to talk about what's in the vaccine and why those might have safety concerns. So we've talked a bit about the antigen when we talked about the different types of vaccine, whether the antigen is simply that component of the vaccine to which the immune system responds. So we've talked that it could be a live but weaker version of the whole microorganism, or just a part, or just a version of the toxin. So we've talked quite a bit about that. But we also have things like stabilizers. Stabilizers are really most important for live attenuated vaccines. There are the things that are added to the vaccine to keep this finicky microorganism happy, so I can think of it, so it doesn't degrade. So these are important for all of these things that are meant to keep the vaccine when it's prepared so that it'll be still effective for use when it finally gets to the clinic and pulled up into the syringe to give to the patient. Everything that you need to add to make sure that vaccine still works when it finally gets there and is ready to be given. And I've given some examples of some types of stabilizers. Adjuvants, I mentioned again, when we pushed our technology to the point where we don't need to give the whole organism, we just use a part of the organism, that might not be enough to stimulate the immune system to the extent that we would like. So we can add adjuvants to increase the production of antibodies, to increase the immune increase the immunogenicity, to use the words, use the language they use in this field. So I've given a couple of examples. Aluminum, a lipid, a form of a lipid, and then ASO3. ASO3, you may have heard about, that's actually the name of one that's particular to a specific drug company. So it's the adjuvant that they have developed. But I always use that example because that was the adjuvant that was in Pandemrix that was associated with narcolepsy. So there was a lot of attention focused on that adjuvant for some time. Aluminum, though, is probably the one that is the most commonly used. It's in a number of the vaccines that we give to children, as well as in one of the HPV vaccines. Antibiotics. Antibiotics can be in vaccines, but they tend to be a very small amounts because they're used really in the manufacturing process, primarily for these live attenuated vaccines, because we want to eliminate the risk for contamination. It's often neomycin you see in a lot of product labels. And this is important to know because, I mean, if you have a patient who's allergic to certain antibiotics, you need to keep this in mind. And then preservatives. These are primarily used when you have a multi-dose vial, when you give many injections from the same bottle, to prevent contamination, and also just sometimes used in the manufacturing process. I guess thimerosal is the one that has received an enormous amount of attention, at least in the United States and in Europe, and has been looked at very carefully, both by EMA as well as USA, but also by the WHO. So it's been the subject of intense scrutiny because it contains ethyl mercury. But right now, the feeling is that the levels of this version of mercury are not at high enough levels to cause significant problems. So that's just to mention. And then finally, we've talked about the different types of vaccines, we've talked about the different ingredients, and now even routes of administration. Things to be thinking about in terms of how vaccines cause adverse events, because we give these by an enormous, a good handful of different mechanisms. This I took from the WHO page, and we have one that's actually missing. I was trying to figure out how I could add it, but which I'll mention. We have oral, intramuscular, subcutaneous, intradermal, and we can say intranasal now. We've started to use intranasal influenza vaccines. In America, pretty routinely, and in Europe, in some countries, they tend to give it to children. So in countries that recommend routine seasonal influenza vaccination of children, they have that. And with these, we might get different types of adverse events. Bell's palsy was noted with some of the first intranasal influenza vaccines. So, you know, you're shooting it up in your nostril and actually occurred on that side of the face. So something to think about. And this is BCG lymphadenitis. You're going to hear this example again because there's probably many different factors that could lead to some of the lymphadenitis we think about. But they do say that one of the risk factors may be an incorrect administration. Instead of actually giving it intradermally, you go too far. You actually go intramuscular. So that was an example there, but you'll see that example again. But I just want to encourage you to think about even where you place, even how you administer, where the vaccine goes in may have consequences for the type of adverse event that you might see. So how do vaccines cause adverse events? So this is actually the part of the lecture that I am the most enthusiastic about. It's the part that I think interests me the most in a way, as I have kind of alluded to earlier. And I think we'll run through this one, this part, and then I think a natural break actually will be before the next part, where I think we'll have a lot of discussion. And I think my slides in this section, just to give you a little pep up maybe, are a little less boring. So, sorry, a few more pictures. So how do vaccine cause adverse events? These are four ways. And I would like to also just kind of encourage you to be thinking about these things when you have an adverse event report cross your desk. I hope that this can be helpful for you to think about that. So they can cause adverse events related to the process of injection. So injection process related. You can also have an enhancement actually of the disease that you're trying to protect against, which we'll go through. Also a direct effect of the vaccine itself, whether that be the antigen, whether that be the stabilizer, the adjuvant. And then also the host response to the vaccine. Actually, vaccine, not component, sorry. The host response to the vaccine. And this last one is probably the area where we're learning more and more. I would say the one at the top we probably know the most about so far, and the one on the bottom is where we're learning more and more. So injection process related. So these are the types of adverse events we typically think of are actually related to getting an injection. And it could be related to getting an injection of any sort, not just a vaccine, but injections that you might get for various other reasons. An adverse event that's related just to injury of the surrounding tissues. The local adverse reaction just from penetrating the skin. Some redness, swelling, pain. But we can also have adverse events even at the level of the nerve or the joint even deeper if the injection is done in an inappropriate way. Syncope. We know that a lot of people don't like to get vaccines. They don't like to get injections. And they can have a vasovagal incident. A vagovagal episode after they get vaccinated. We also know that some people can faint before they get a vaccine. My husband being a good example. bleeding. Anytime we pierce the skin, of course, we can have bleeding consequences. Also, injection process related can be related just to the vaccine, not thinking of what happens to the person, but we can have contamination at the level of multi-dose vials. That's why we put thimerosal and things in it. But it still can happen that these can get contaminated. So we can cause a problem that way. I just have to give an aside because it was incredibly interesting to me. In my previous life, I worked in infectious diseases epidemiology, and I was involved in an outbreak investigation for group A streptococcus. And it was actually foodborne, which was a little interesting because we tend to think of it more as a respiratory thing, but this was actually... But I actually found an example of a cluster of children that had group A streptococcus skin infections, which they ended up identifying it being on the surface of a vaccine multi-dose vial. I thought that was really interesting. I'd never heard that before. So also just transmission of blood-borne pathogens, which if you reuse a needle, for example, that's probably less common these days, but and then inappropriate dilutants. I'm going to give an example. These live attenuated vaccines sometimes come in a form that have to be reconstituted. And there have been mistakes made in how to reconstitute the vaccines. A wrong dilutant was taken. And again, all of these are related to the actual process of preparing the vaccine, drawing it up in the needle, and giving it to the person. So an example of what we talked about, I mentioned before, that more rare happening than just skin adverse events are things that could happen if the needle goes too far. So a condition, SIVRA, soldier injury related to vaccine administration, has been described where there was actually unintentional injection of the antigenic material as far as the synovial tissues, and then there was an immune response that resulted in the synovial tissue and a bit of an arthritis in the joint capsule. So that can happen again, but related to the injection and not probably could have happened with any type of injection potentially. Again, another types of injection process related, this is the example of inappropriate dilutants. I couldn't find a less busy slide, I apologize, but I've tried to circle two of the examples. WHO in 1996 gave a pretty thorough, did a thorough review of examples where there had been AEFIs that were related to the fact that it was an injury, it was an injection process related. And here was an example where measles vaccine was suspended with the wrong solvent, and they ended up having some adverse events which manifested as cyanosis and tachycardia. And then they also had, here I circled this other example of an example of contamination. So Staph aureus contaminated the vaccine, and it manifested with children having fever and tachycardia, vomiting. So that's all of injection process related. So another way that vaccines can cause adverse events is so-called enhancement of the target disease. And I have this one example here, and it's an old one, because I actually haven't been around to have seen an example of this in my 10 years, shall we say, of doing this. But it will be interesting to see with time if we see any more. But back in the 1960s, they actually developed an inactivated vaccine against RSV disease. And it was formalin inactivated, and it was given to infants, and it induced what was called neutralizing antibodies. But what they found, actually, that the children, the infants who received the vaccine, ended up being more susceptible to disease from RSV. And this probably comes from the effects of the vaccine on the immune system. And this is an area I don't want to get into because I don't know it all that well either. But I would just leave it to say that I know enough to know that sometimes people can have a hyporesponse. So their immune system actually seeing the microorganism a second time, they actually may not have the immune response that they had when they saw it the first time. And this is getting to be more and more appreciated and better described with time. But here was an example where we got the opposite response than we expected. But again, an old example, and I don't know of any recent ones. Probably because we have a greater recognition for the fact that that can happen, and they can develop things to deal with that. So I only had one slide on that part. So now moving on to the ones that we probably, back to direct, that we know more about, the direct effect of the vaccine component. So these are different things about the vaccine, not just the injection, but actually the vaccine itself that can affect the risk for an adverse event. So this is a list of the different types of things about the vaccine that may result in an adverse event. So a type of vaccine, we've talked a bit about that already when I went through them. Live attenuated vaccines can result in adverse events that are a mild form of the disease, so shall we say. Strain, attenuation, manufacturing process, again, all these things that have to do with all the ingredients that this biological product has, and different ways in which they're manufactured. So also on here is that we give other vaccines simultaneously. I'll give you an example of that. So I would say that we're growing to have a greater and greater appreciation of these types of adverse events as well. So here's an example that of an influenza vaccine in 2000-2001 season that in Canada, I believe it was, they used a new vaccine that was made by one particular supplier. And they noticed this adverse event, which they gave the name of oculorespiratory syndrome. And it was characterized by having bilateral conjunctivitis, face edema, and respiratory symptoms that had a pretty near temporal onset after getting the vaccine. When they investigated this, they actually found that this vaccine had an increased proportion of high molecular weight compounds of unsplit and aggregated virions. I think that's a very complicated way of just telling you that, you know, when they manufactured it, that they all the way that the vaccine ended up is it had it created a virion that maybe had a different type of that elicited a different type of immune response than they initially thought. So maybe that manufacturing process, I don't know. I don't know if that was used again. But so that was actually directly related to the way the vaccine was made. Another example from influenza vaccine. Again, a particular influenza vaccine that was made by one particular company. It was used in one particular country. This was in Australia a little bit more recently in 2010, where they noticed that in children, I guess they routinely immunize children in Australia against influenza. I don't know if I can say that, actually. But it was in children that they were seeing this. And they noticed a very high incidence, higher than expected incidence of febrile seizures and fever. But they didn't see it with the other influenza vaccines that were available, that were also being used. It was only one, all of these children were noted to have gotten the same product that was titled CSL trivalent. So they investigated what went on with that. And they ended up thinking that it was a year that they used new strains of the new strains of influenza that they incorporated into the virus that year. They thought it was related to that, as well as differences in the way they were manufactured compared to the others. And this is just an example of the different types of vaccines, all the different vaccines that they used that year. And they noticed that this one had, it resulted that the children were having a much higher production of these interleukins compared to all the other ones. So it affected the immune system. It elicited a response that was different and looked a bit more increased compared to the other ones. And so this was thought to be the rationale as to why these children manifested with these adverse events compared to the others. This one I give as an example. It actually didn't result in an adverse event, but just to keep in mind, Rotarix, a live attenuated vaccine. I actually must apologize because I'm not sure. I think it was just on a quality check. So this is a live attenuated vaccine. And in fact, in the manufacturing process, they noted that there were low levels of a viral particle that were in the culturing, that were in the process of culturing it. And it was just a quality check that they noticed that it wasn't all eliminated, actually, from the vaccine product as it should have been. They didn't find any evidence that this caused any problems, but that's something just to think about, that these vaccine manufacturers have to keep a constant watch on these products because they can vary even from batch to batch. And this didn't result in anything, but just to keep in mind about how this works. This is related to this idea of my list of things, type, strain, I put on the bottom when vaccines are given together. Another influenza vaccine are all my examples, it seems. This from the United States. They noticed an increase again in children having febrile seizures when they were receiving influenza vaccine. In America, a lot of the influenza vaccines were being given at the same time that they gave pneumococcal vaccine. And what they were able to see is that when each of these influenza and pneumococcal were given separately, they had a much lower rate. But when you gave them together, at a much higher rate of febrile seizures. That's probably the better example. I put this example on here because I worked really hard on this one. When I was in the regulatory world, we had a signal that came from a country. They had been using the pneumococcal vaccine Prevnar 7, which was the first licensed pneumococcal vaccine. And then the company developed Prevnar 13. That was the product that I had, which replaced Prevnar 7. So it has six additional serotypes that it provides protection against. And one of the countries has a national immunization program, well, as most all of them do, that it's given at the same time you give your pentavalent or hexavalent vaccine for diphtheria, tetanus, pertussis, etc. But they noticed when they transitioned from Prevnar 7 to Prevnar 13, this particular country was using a hexavalent vaccine, so they were incorporating hepatitis B at the same time. Not all countries in Europe do that. But they transitioned from a combination of hexavalent and Prevnar 7 to the combination of hexavalent and Prevnar 13. And they too thought that they saw an increased rate of febrile seizures, again, and this hypotonic hyporesponsive episode. And we do know the data definitely showed, even in clinical trials, that we get a higher immunogenicity, a higher reactogenic response. We knew that patients got more fevers and a bit more local reactions when we give the 13 compared to the 7. So it kind of makes pathologic sense that this could happen more often. And they actually ended up doing a study to show it. It wasn't statistically significant, but they showed an increased rate. And I had worked on that for about 1.5 years to get that included in the label for Prevnar 13, that this had been observed. So not as pretty. And the final way that vaccines can cause adverse events are the host factors. And again, as I mentioned before, this is probably the area that we're learning more and more about. And that's one of the things I would like to pass on to you in this talk. But so this is the last one, host responses. So age, gender, prior dose of the vaccine, prior infection, pre-existing hypersensitivity, immune deficiency, and genetics. So these are all different things about the host that may influence the adverse event profile that they could have from a vaccine. So this is the example for the hypersensitivity. We do know that some children, when they get a booster dose of their DPT, they can have really extensive arm swelling. And this has actually been incorporated into the labels of most of these vaccines, I do believe. And this study actually looked to see that, yeah, I mean, these children look differently. Their immune response, they have a high T2 response, that's just, and a high IgE. So these children look immunologically different than those children who don't have this problem. So it's not just the arm, it's what's happening at the immunological level. And why they respond to that also remains we have to work on. So hosts can have immunodeficiencies. We can know about them and we cannot know about them yet at an infant level. So we have a number of reports of vaccine-acquired rotavirus in infants that have, well, severe combined immunodeficiency in this example. There's other case reports with others. And the issue here is, I mean, that makes sense. We know that they have to be very careful, or we don't, maybe contraindicated to give a live attenuated vaccine to someone with an immune deficiency. But this paper was written to point out that we may not know about an immune deficiency in a child at 2 months of age. They may not have manifested yet. So this was a case series where they reported 5 children that had gotten the vaccine and they ended up very ill and their immune deficiency was subsequently diagnosed. So the vaccine adverse event is actually what was the manifestation of their immune deficiency. So this goes with the genetics I put on the bottom. This is where I think the future lies, that we've begun to scratch the surface. There's even a term for it now, which I just recently learned. Adversomics, the emerging field of adverse event immunogenetics. So Gregory Poland, you may have seen his name before. He's actually the editor of the journal Vaccine. He's kind of a big person in the field of vaccines. We have hypothesized that adverse reactions and events may not be random, but in fact, may be in part genetically predetermined. And here are some examples we have so far. Genetic basis for adverse events after smallpox vaccination. So they've identified genetic polymorphisms in genes related to a transcription factor in patients that have that have adverse events from smallpox. I'll leave it there. MMR vaccine. This was recently, 2014, in Denmark. They've looked and they see that there are genetic differences between those children that have febrile seizures after MMR vaccine. Totally accepted. We know that MMR can result in febrile seizures for some children. This may explain why my son, who had a fever very high, almost 40 degrees, for 2 days, he didn't have a febrile seizure, though, but he was pretty ill. And this is also a very recent publication, 2016, in Nature Immunology. And when they looked at the adjuvanted influenza H1N1 vaccine, they saw that people that reported adverse events had a different molecular signature. They had immunotypic variation. They looked at the immune response, the interleukins, everything, and they saw that these people were different. They responded differently immunologically than those people that didn't have adverse events. I don't think any of us think this is a surprise, but I think we finally see it documented. Now going back to the BCG lymphadenitis, this will be the last slide before a break. It's complicated enough to think we can have injection process related, we can have a direct effect of the vaccine, we can have the host responsive vaccine, but then we have a good example of them all here. I think this is a really good example of BCG. We know that some people can really, we can have the adverse event of BCG lymphadenitis. And we, in fact, think that this can happen because it's injected wrongly, so injection related. It's not just given intradermally, it's given intramuscularly, is a risk factor for developing this. We've also found that there's things related to the vaccine that can increase the chance of this. Certain strains of the BCG, how viable they are, and if you give the wrong dose, can be a risk factor for this. But we also know there's host-related factors. It's very well documented that this occurs more commonly in infants. Also, it occurs more commonly in patients that have HIV. And there may be also a genetic underlying factor. So just to make it even more complicated, we can have effects from all these different types of ways vaccines cause adverse events.